I'm Dr. Azra Bertrand. I'm an author, I'm an alchemical physician, and I'm a biomancer. I'm the founder of a work called Biomancy, which is an exploration of the magic in our bodies and in nature, and opening and awakening to that relationship. I'm here today to have a conversation about being a guardian of the green. And this metaphor of being a guardian, of being a gardener of the land, and this incredible symbiotic relationship between human and land and plants that our ancestors all lived, that they all knew and they all lived, but it's been forgotten in the modern world by many people. I'm here at Mountain Gardens in the Appalachian Mountains of North Carolina at this property that's stewarded by Joe Hollis. Joe Hollis has lived and worked here for 50 years, cultivating this magical relationship with the plants and with the land. It's 4 acres of shaded mountain cove primarily, and it is filled with so many different kinds of plants and beautiful energy, really a beautiful chi as Joe describes it. And from his talk and from what I felt here, I was really opened into a deeper sense of what's possible for how we can live and be with plants in the earth. I also speak about ecomancy, which is about the magic of the ecosystems or ecology and how we relate with that, how the plants influence our consciousness, and how we also are allies to the plants, how there's this devotional relationship or this love relationship or this open relationship where there's communication and listening and really an exchange of energy or biofields. As humans, we have biofields, and plants have biofields too. So this ecomantic view or perspective of relating to the land that we're on. Ecomancy is the study and awareness of the magic in our ecosystems or ecology, and how that really affects humans, how that affects us. Plants have memories, they learn, they have what's called associative memory or imaginations, and they affect our consciousness. So Joe Hollis has lived and worked in this field of intelligence where the plants, he allows the plants to guide his inspiration or his enthusiasm, as he calls it, and really co-create with them and with the energies of the earth.
So my name is Joe Hollis. I've been on this, I bought this land I call Mountain Gardens in 1972. It was 2.8 acres and it was entirely wooded. It had never been farmed. So this is back in the 60s, you know, back to the land movement and all that going on. After college, I went into the Peace Corps, because this is during the Vietnam War and the draft and all that. I went into the Peace Corps. They sent me to the north coast of Borneo. It's called Sarawak, East Malaysia. And I got a job working up and down a river, visiting primary schools and trying to kind of upgrade the level of teaching. So this was a pretty much intact tribal society. They practiced slash and burn agriculture. The villages were called longhouses. Everybody lived in one big longhouse. Of course, I fell madly in love with it. It was just fantastic. It was, you know, so much the opposite of the way I grew up. I mean, here was people who were pretty largely self-reliant. They built their houses, they grew their food, you know, they weren't tied into anything, and they were quite evidently healthier and happier than anybody in America that I knew. So this totally changed my life, you know, and I was offered this little piece of land, 2.8 acres at the end of the road. So I came up here, looked around, kind of got the idea of where the boundaries were, walk right about where we're standing right now, which is more or less the middle of the property, looked down and I saw the first ginseng plant I've ever seen. Just like a picture out of a book with the red berries. Must have been this time of year, I guess. And so if I needed any affirmation, that was it, you know. I prayed to the great spirits at one point to just give me a couple acres of strip mine and I would show what I could do. And they gave me this instead, which is just a marvelous piece of land. Has three or four different plant communities, even though it's 2.8 acres. Like tremendous diversity in here, which I came to understand. I don't believe anything happens by accident. It's all guided, you know. Yeah. So
yeah,
that's how I got here. And my idea was just to try and develop a way to live on Earth that is A, good for the Earth, and B, good for human society, equal rights and justice, and C, good for me or whoever. And if you could find a way to live that fulfills all those three criteria, that's one of my definitions of paradise.
Yeah.
I have other definitions as well. So the way that works out in practice is what I call a botanical garden of useful plants grown ecologically and arranged ornamentally. Another one of my definitions of a paradise garden. In other words, I'm trying to create a beautiful garden, beautiful by my standards, like the place that I want to live, you know, what I want to be in the middle of. But all the plants are, and in that I'm kind of guided by a combination of English landscape gardening and Chinese gardening. Those are my two big influences as far as aesthetic designs, and then but all the plants should be useful for some purpose. I spent a lot of time looking at, every winter I would go back down to Chapel Hill and just spend 3 months in the library doing research on all these topics, one of which was the origins of agriculture, which I think, and a lot of people think, is where our species took the wrong turn. Somewhere along the line, we took the wrong turn. You know, we were living as part of Gaia, just like all the other creatures here. It's one huge living organism. Life started once. We're all related. Everything out here is the same age as me. You know, if we don't think about my personal body, but it's my genes, right? So my genes go all the way back to the beginning, to the first spark of life on Earth. And that's everything out here, the bugs, the microbes, the trees, the birds, it's all the same. Their genes all go back to that original spark. So of course, a lot of people don't want to hear that. Why? Because if you believe that, then it has implications for how we live on this planet. It's just not, I mean, we have a role to play, just like every part of my body has a role to play in keeping me healthy. And if one little part of my body, my liver or my kidney, whatever, decides to just set up business on its own, that's called cancer, you know? And then I die and it dies.
I first met you in maybe 2014, and in the setting of coming to hear your vision and your ideas about a paradise garden, paradise gardening, and what that meant for you. And I was really touched. It was what I saw here was remarkable. And at that point, you'd already been doing it for 40 years or something. And what I saw was someone who had just chosen deliberately to live so closely to the land, you know, to the earth and the plants. And for me, it sparked a real curiosity to know, well, what have the plants shared with you in essence? You know, when you live so closely to all of these sentient beings, and like you say, we share, you know, we come from the same place. We have the same common ancestors as plants. If you go back 3.5 billion years or something like that, we share 20% of our genes are actually shared, homologous at least, with plants. We share the same neurotransmitters, you know, dopamine, serotonin.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, they don't have brains, but they certainly have intelligence, and a vast one. And for, you know, from a biomantic perspective or a biomagical perspective, how has it been to live with plants in this way, in the earth this way? And my question is, how has your perspective changed, or how has the intelligence of this system or this network of organisms that you're so deeply embedded in shifted you, changed you, you know, symbiosed with you?
Well, when I first started, I really didn't know what I was doing. I just had some kind of vague ideas about it, and I had a Foxfire book about how to build a log cabin, you know, and I just started in doing things. I've always felt like I don't want to be the decision maker here, you know. I don't want to, like, impose my ideas, although I am, but really I've always wanted to be guided. So, like, I never made a design on paper, for instance, of where this is going, you know. I'm going to have the paths here, I'm going to plant this, which is kind of like what the permaculture people do, you know, they make a plan. But that's, you know, that's very ego-driven. I really didn't want that. As much as possible, I wanted the development of this place to be a partnership between me and all other things living here.
I love this, because we are 100% dependent on plants, you know. All of our, every molecule in our body comes at some point from plants, whether we eat plants or whether we eat animals that have eaten those plants, or whether we breathe the oxygen that's been created by those plants, or, you know, it's a, this incredible symbiotic entangled relationship we have with plants. I think that a lot of people don't fully appreciate it, but as you're living here very close to all the different plants, the medicinal herbs, the trees, the bushes, I would imagine that there's some kind of a field that you enter into.
There is Gaia, which is where all creatures, including humans, have their needs met. Like, we fulfill a certain niche within Gaia, and we are rewarded by having all our needs. Like, bears, animals, whatever, all of them fulfill a certain niche. And my feeling was that we lost our niche. That's the whole problem, is we lost our niche. We no longer fit into Gaia. Instead, we set up our own alternate system, for which I use the word civilization, but you could call it the economy, or you could call it the state, whatever you want to call it. The newest word now is capital. And we fit ourselves into that. So you ask somebody what they do for a living, they're going to tell you how they make money, right? That's not where we should be, you know. We should be making our living from a direct relationship with Gaia, just like every other creature does, and just like we did up until we took this wrong turn. And now we're so immersed in this wrong turn that nobody even thinks anymore that it's possible to meet our needs from a direct relationship with Gaia.
I think that's such a key piece. And I know that so many people feel that, that rather than being dependent on civilization for money, for even healthcare, transportation, etc., what if we could source so much more of our needs directly from the earth, like our ancestors did, and really, in a sense, in a new way, because of course it'll be in a new way, just go back, really, go back to these fundamentals.
Back to the future.
Yeah, exactly. We source our food, not just our food, but our medicines. Not just our medicines, but when we're able to hand build the homes and the structures we live in, when we are more closely connected to where the fibers come or the skins come that we use for our warmth. And like you say, just step back from this dependence on this really man-made system and how far off track it's gone, how we have left this niche, you know, this natural way of being with the earth, with the sun, with, you know, with the moon, with the stars.
Yep.
And how strong that call is to return back to it. And I know that so many people feel it and they may not know how to access it. And I know that's part of what draws people here to see what you've done and part of the beauty and magic of this space that you've created. Because it's really what I feel when I'm here, as I feel an energy that's different than most places. And you know, whether it's the absence of the noises of the kind of man-made world of cars and trucks and machines and etc., or whether it's the fragrance and the chemicals that are of communication that the plants are releasing, because of course they do release things that affect our biology and our consciousness, our mood, and all this is actually really well studied now, particularly in the Japanese forest bathing research.
Yep. So the idea of a Chinese garden, what's called a Taoist garden, is to create a situation for personal self-development. So it's really about, creating a situation of perfect qi. Because we get our qi from the environment. We get our qi from our food and from the air that we breathe. So in order to develop, so what happens in a Chinese garden is you want to set a situation with perfect qi, and then people write poetry, they do painting, they meditate, they do tai chi exercises, play the lute, all these different activities that you are doing for personal self-growth. And it's all about, and they've put a lot of energy into this, is creating a situation where you can gather more qi, because that's how we develop ourselves, you know.
I'm going to bounce back to this idea of qi and drawing in qi from the environment, and how it's this, on one hand, it's a beautiful metaphor, the way some people think about it, that it's a these are just spiritual or non-physical energies, or, you know, that it's metaphysical, that it's all metaphysical, is the way some people might think of that. But the really wonderful and amazing thing about some of the leading edge science is that we realize it's not just metaphysical, and neither is it just a metaphor. Everything has a biofield, just like humans. We have an electromagnetic field that extends out beyond our body. We also have airborne molecules, we have pheromones, and we secrete exosomes of genetic material out into the environment around us. But all of these living creatures are doing that. And all of these living creatures, all the plants, all the animals here, of course the humans,
have a field of intelligence that's not just limited, it's not just in the mind, but it's a body intelligence or somatic intelligence. Just like plants have memory, they learn, they produce songs to communicate with other plants, insects, etc. They have a pulsing, living, flowing electromagnetic or electrodermal patterns, just like humans, you know, in plant leaves. You can hook up a sensor and convert it into music to a plant, right? Yeah. But just, you could do the same with a human, you know, and how these, there is a field of chi, there is a sea of chi that we're swimming in, and how we can learn to bring that in, how we can learn to bring in the chi from the sunlight, and how it very literally is contributing photons, electrons. Mm-hmm. It's creating vitamin D, the sunlight. Right. It's doing much more than that. Its infrared spectrum is activating our mitochondria. It's in the near infrared spectrum of light. It turns on our mitochondria, so it helps in wound healing. It helps in blood flow. There's so much happening, and beginning to relate to this sea of chi as in metaphysical ways, which I feel is really valuable, in spiritual ways, and also in this, I call it biomantic or biomagical, how these unseen forces are unseen to our you know, to our eyes, or perhaps to our ears, or we may not be able to touch them directly, are infusing this us with a really tangible energy. To me, that's beautiful and fascinating. I feel that really you are a pioneer in this, a guardian of the green, you know, a guardian of this new kind of connectedness to the land, and people are drawn to that. So it's a vision, you know, it's a rare vision here in this modern age, but it's a vision that would only make sense to people in the past, to our ancestors, even several hundred years ago. And so to me, mountain gardens is it's a seed, you know, it's a seed of a potential of culture, of a potential of new ways of living. And to me, that's both healthy and beautiful, that it's connected, and we're drawing from these benefits of how the ecology and the local environment makes us healthy, makes us, the more we're connected, well, the less we're going to need other forms of entertainment, other forms of health, other forms, because there's just so much richness. There's so much happening. And even the simple things of waking when there is natural light and sun, and having that set our circadian rhythms rather than a bunch of artificial lighting, having the natural geomagnetic field of the earth, and the Schumann resonance, the electromagnetic field between atmosphere and the Earth's surface, having that entrain our bioelectromagnetic processes, because we are bioelectric beings. We have electrical fields, of course, that extend out as in a field around this, in a toroidal field. You know, this is how EKGs or ECGs work. They're measuring our electrical potential, and EEGs that measure our brain's potential. Well, we're surrounded by these fields, and when we can feel that, and when we can be in those energies, I feel that something beautiful emerges. And I really feel it's a part of the inspiration or the enthusiasm. It gives us something that we can't even touch. It's a mystery that then guides us, so that we can work with it together in partnership or co-create with it.
Yeah. It's deep in us. You know, we're not born empty. We're born with a program. In this situation, working with nature, it's all totally integrated. I'm out there gathering my food. At the same time, I'm being inspired by the beauty of it all. I'm getting exercise, doing, you know, it's all like happening at the same time. All my needs are integrated. I personally feel like every creature out there is enlightened except humans, and possibly some of our pets, whom we have sort of warped their intelligence a bit too. But by and large, I think the rest of them are all wandering around the bears and the possums in an enlightened state of being, of connectedness with the whole thing. And it's just us who have lost that somehow. And so that's the goal, is to get back to that, to like live again this enlightened state with the whole planet, and and just being constantly thankful for the beauty of the whole thing. I mean, it's the older I get, the more I'm just overwhelmed by the beauty and intricacy of the planet. Every morning I get up and just say, thank you, Great Spirits, for giving me one more day on this beautiful, beautiful planet. And it's so, as we're learning, so finely tuned, you know, everything is so much in balance. Just think about water and how that works, and what the fact that water freezes at 32 degrees and boils, you know, and the implications of that for how everything works, and the glaciers and how they store water, you know, on and on and on.
It's a magically tuned process. You know, I think it was Roger Penrose, who was a British mathematician, who applied amazing math to study the probability of how life could actually happen. And it was beyond improbable. There was some telos there, some energy, some field that must be guiding not just us, but all of life. Otherwise, statistically, all of these things are beyond improbable.
I think our sense of beauty is where we really tie into Gaia. But this whole idea of beauty, I think that's where evolution wants to go. It just wants to make everything more and more beautiful. And our sense of what's beautiful is not random. That's the reality, that's where we tie into Gaia's, what Gaia is trying to do, is by our sense of what is beautiful.
Yeah.
Beauty. I just think the idea of beauty is a very important thing to guide us. Mm. That what we're supposed to be doing on this planet is making it beautiful.
Yeah.
That's what everything wants to do. Like the butterflies and the birds, and why is everything so colorful? Why is everything so beautiful? Because that's what Gaia is trying to do, is make it more beautiful.
Thank you for taking this journey with us. I feel such gratitude for this place and for what Joe has created, nestled on the ancestral homelands of the Cherokee, here in Appalachia, in some of the oldest mountains in the world. The plants are our ancestors, who speak the language of beauty and possibility, and it's time to listen to them. Earth is full of eco-magic, and we belong to that. We must dream and hold a new vision for a reconnected future, and the ancient wisdom of the earth can guide us.